It's 9 o'clock, and we'll start the Board of Commissioners meeting for Blue Earth County for June 9th, 2015. We'll start with the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, right to our agenda review, Bob.
Mr. Chair, there are no changes to the agenda this morning.
I'll move the agenda.
Second.
All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Against? Okay, Commissioners' reports on committees. Start with Kip this morning.
All righty. After our last board meeting, we had the AMC district meeting over in Brown County. I thought that meeting went pretty well. A lot of information. It was nice to see Jackie Mines there from the regional radio or emergency communication 911 stuff. We've been trying to get her to that meeting for quite a while and was able to get her in there, and I think she brought a lot of good information for us to take back and work on. A couple days later I had my EMS meeting. Things are going really well with EMS. Funding's starting to come through again. They were going to try to put us under the Department of Health, but that legislation didn't pass, so we're still kind of on our own and with the public safety. And the grants are coming in and the seatbelt money's coming in, so it looks like we're going to be funded again for another couple years. Had a couple MRCI meetings. We had a review for Brian Benchoof, who's been our CEO for the last about 3 years. He's doing a fine job up there at MRCI, so we decided to keep him on for another year. So, and then we had our MRCI board meeting. Things are going real well there. Candy business is picking up a little bit. Seem to be getting things ready for the summer promotions. Just starting to do different things with MRCI, and Brian's trying to get more feedback from the whole board instead of trying to just run it the way that him and the staff think CC fits. He wants more input from the whole entire board. So we're going to be having some breakout sessions and some meetings when we meet and kind of tell them what direction we want MRCI to go, which is difficult as a board because, you know, they know what MRCI does and what they do, so we'll take a lot of information from the staff and kind of work with Brian on that, and he's really excited about that. He wants the board to get more involved, which I'm all for that. So then we had the United Way luncheon. I was at that with Jesse, and that was a good turnout. There's a couple hundred people there, and Glenn Taylor came and spoke about the United Way and supporting the United Way, and they got a big campaign of $2 million is what they want to raise. So they're going to be working really hard on that for the next year or so. So we're going to brainstorm and we have a very good presentation from Blue Earth County employees, very appreciative of that. But we can always just try a little harder. So then I was at the department head meeting, and then that night after that I was at planning and zoning. We had several things on the planning and zoning meeting, so we'll see those at the end of this month, and there is a handful. They all went very well, a couple public comments, but otherwise everything was pretty well put together. But it is just going to be a little longer meeting for our P&Z at the end of the month. That's my report, Mr. Chair.
Mark?
Okay, yep, we had AMC District 7 meeting on the 27th, and that was an interesting meeting. And then we had, I went to the clubhouse, open house, on the 28th. I think several of you were there, didn't you? I was there actually when Senator Sharon and Representative Considine were just about ready to go, but...
Nice.
That was a nice thing to go to every. Well, this was their two-year anniversary. Yeah. It was at Vine Building. Then May 30th, I did see the chair of our county board at the Boy in Blue dedication, nice. Along with the congressman and two state representatives, and quite a good crowd. We were looking for you, but
I was gone.
You were gone.
Yeah.
Oh, well, we represented your area well.
Yeah, we represented.
Oh, I know. I really wish I could have been there because I heard they had a real
very, very good crowd and cool presentation. It was kind of like a the old way. Bryce is like the old way, you know, with everybody giving those speeches It was cool, neat program. Weather was good. Yeah, and the weather was good. So it was.
In Mankato, other than maybe in, say, Sibley Park, I can't think of another fountain we even have in the city of Mankato.
No, I don't think there is. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And this is the only, like, the old style fountain.
And the mayor was there. He promised then that the city would keep it up because, you know, the one prior to that was kind of got neglected. And so.
Yeah.
So that was kind of neat. And then, of course, the battery, and, well, they didn't fire a cannon. They would have blown windows out, but the new old brigade, or the battery was there.
Did they have a salute?
Back in the old days, they did that.
Yeah, Tom McLaughlin was there, and he did tell about, or at least when I was standing with him, he talked about how they, a number of years ago, they shot a cannon off and blew a bunch of windows out.
I heard about that, too.
It wasn't even aimed at him, it just was, yeah. Anyway, that was pretty cool. And then June 3rd, yep, we had the department heads. And then the 4th of June, I did have a state health improvement program or meeting with Chris Frederick here. And that went well. Just getting a lot of community involvement, a lot of different organizations. I think there's too many of them coming up. There's another bike ride kind of thing coming up, a children's thing. And so it's a lot of activities to try to get people in a healthier lifestyle. So that concludes my program, Mr. Chair.
Thank you.
Of course, our last meeting was May 26th. On Wednesdays, for some reason, the last couple of weeks, Wednesdays have been really full for me. It's a big middle of the week, busy day. But Wednesday the 27th, of course, AMC district meeting in New Ulm. And then later on that day, I stopped in at an open house I was invited to at the Mayo Health. Here in Mankato, they had a what they call Quality Improvement Day program. They had a lot of staff there that are involved with, you know, an organization that size, they have to have staff actually involved with just quality improvement and looking at how they do things. And I met, I think he's one of the directors, Dr. Nessie. You know, he's pretty, I don't think he's a top guy, but he probably could be the chief operating director, I think, I'm not sure. But, and then Greg Kucher, of course, was there. On the same day, later on that afternoon, we had a community ed and rec advisory council meeting. Typically, those are about an hour long. And after that, we moved into what was called the Spirit of Youth Awards there at Lincoln. I believe it's the third year they've been doing this. They ask for people to send in names, and they have a committee that, you know, reviews kids that have done things in the community or adults that do things to help bolster youth, and it's really quite a program, and that little theater fills up. I mean, it's basically full, and I just happen to be the MC again this year. They asked me to MC that program, so
I couldn't think of anybody better.
Yeah. you know, the first time I did it, it was a little nerve-wracking.
And they invited you back, so that's
and they still invited me back.
Yeah.
So. But it is really fun to hear the stories.
Did you sing?
No, I didn't sing. I could offer that next year, I guess, if they want me to do it again.
You have a great voice.
Thank you. Did you want me to sing now?
No.
Oh, okay.
You could sing, you could also but you could do the spoons, too.
Well, that's true. I'm a professional spoon.
I know you're,
not spooner, because that's a spoon player. So, May 29th, we had that Friday, the South Central Regional Workshop. It's an annual event. That's right down in Fairmont, and there was, I think, about 80 people that had gathered there, and it's really quite it's something if you've never been to one. I'd really like to encourage, I know that Will, you know, has been involved with his background in law enforcement. I know that Vance has also, but if you guys haven't ever been to one, there's actually an annual statewide one in St. Cloud this fall, if you're interested in going to St. Cloud. And they typically stay overnight for that type of one. So, very good. I had to leave right after the luncheon portion to make it to the something else I had going on in town.
That TZD was very good, though. I mean, I was there with you.
Yes. Yeah.
So that was really a good, really showing the support for our emergency personnel and stuff too, which is.
Did you stay great. For the afternoon?
Yeah, one of the classes at.
Yeah.
I take off.
Okay, yeah. One of the ones I attended was on actually diversity, trying to get the word out, because one of the things is, you know, education and trying to get the word out to a more diverse community, trying to invite them in to understanding the issues regarding safety. They come here from other cultures where maybe it's not talked about as much. Sometimes you get immigrants here that don't talk about road safety as much as we do here. We've reduced a lot of fatalities and serious accidents just through the educational efforts that we have going on here in this country. So that was pretty good too. Now, spin forward to the next Wednesday. I got another full schedule. Drove over to MNRA, which is the Minnesota River Area Agency on Aging. We had our board of directors meeting there in the morning. And of course, as I've been reporting, they're going through a complete sort of reorganizing, pulling away from Region 9 as being their primary, administration that they've been working with. For many years, Region 9 has supported and been a part of MNRA. But the Minnesota Board of Aging ultimately oversees, you know, the activities of MNRA. And so, after a lot of hours of researching and consulting, a month or so ago, MNRA decided to separate from Region 9. And so they have to look at benefit packages going forward for their employees. They have to look how they're going to provide services in southern Minnesota. So that covered a lot of those things at that board meeting. That afternoon in Redwood Falls was a conference that only happens every 10 years. It's called the White House Conference on Aging. And it's actually a federal, I don't know if it's a request or a mandate, but it comes through the states if they're receiving funds for these Area Agency on Aging to get feedback and to have listening sessions. And this year's four themes that were requested was retirement security, healthy aging, long-term services and supports, and elder justice. And so we spent the whole afternoon, about, I think there was 40 people that from the area that do a lot of different aspects of helping support elders and seniors in our southern part of the state. And so that was a wonderful thing to do. And that concludes my report, Mr. Chair. And
you did great.
You looked at his watch.
Well, okay, mine is relatively brief. The AMC district meeting has already been mentioned. That afternoon, Kip and I were at the joint Ditch 11 meeting with the Waseca County Commissioners. Then on the 1st, I had the briefing at the Crystal Seasons Assisted Living in Lake Crystal. And department heads on the 3rd, and then the ACHF committee at TDS. Unfortunately, we don't know this yet, but it looks like the funding for the ACHF will be cut by about $50,000 for next year. So, but we'll deal with that as it comes. But that's my report.
All right. Well, and for my report, again, we had the District 7 meeting. That Friday, I attended the same Toward Zero Death conference that Drew did. Again, it was a very good conference, showing how Minnesota really is leading the way in Toward Zero Death and how the whole United States is coming on board and following Minnesota's lead. That's pretty impressive, especially when I went out to the Transportation Alliance fly-in then the next week, and they start talking about Towards Zero Death on a national level and how they're taking Minnesota's lead.
That's
so it's pretty important. Again, that Saturday, the Boy in Blue was there with Mark, and a nice that park was filled, although it's a very small park, but it's it really,
they figure 150.
Yeah, it really had a lot of people. I thought a lot of people in there. At the Transportation Alliance, met with many of our congressmen, Rick Nolan, Eric Paulson, of course Tim Walz, met with Amy Klobuchar, met with Franken. When we went to Franken's office and Klobuchar's office, they weren't actually in there. But then during, we had different sessions later, and they came and we were able to
really get our point across and talked about funding and stuff for counties and states in the state of Minnesota. On Monday, yesterday, we had our agenda discussion with Bob, and that's a nice short one I had. How's that? So, I think about this time, I'm going to entertain a motion to recess the county board meeting for the motion. Economic Development Authority meeting.
Motion to recess for the EDA meeting.
Second.
Got a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
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 And I'm going to hand it over. I'm going to call the meeting to order.
Welcome, Patty.
Better do that first, huh? And then I'll hand it over to Patty.
Okay.
Hi, Patty.
Morning, Patty.
I suppose we should approve the agenda, though.
Yeah.
Motion to approve the agenda.
So moved. Second.
And all in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
A motion to approve the minutes.
Motion to approve the minutes, Mr. Chair.
Second.
We got a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Now I'll hand it over to Patty.
Okay. Here today to ask for a resolution to accept the grant agreement for the Bridges Program funding for 2015 through 2017. You might remember that we've been administering the Bridges Program for Blue Earth County residents for quite a number of years now. It is a program that provides a housing subsidy while people who are mentally ill wait for a Section 8 voucher. So it basically keeps people off the streets that otherwise might very well be homeless. We have a memorandum of understanding with Blue Earth County Human Services. Social workers at the county make referrals to our office for people to go on the Bridges waiting list. Right now we have about 35 people on the waiting list. We have 9 slots. In the last 2 years, we received 3 additional slots from the state, and this is a state-funded program. So that is why we have a $39,000 increase over the funding that we received previously. It's to pay for those additional slots that we have. We did apply for an additional 5 slots, but the state didn't award any additional slots to anyone in the state. So.
Excuse me, how many did you say we were short then, even with the extra slots?
Well,
we have 9 now. We had 6 up until the funding period 2 years ago. We were awarded 3 additional slots, and then I asked for an additional 5 and didn't get it.
But then how many are we short as far as how many people that we have on the waiting list again?
That's about 35 on the waiting list.
Okay.
So this is additional funding that they get. They may be on some other programs that help them with different issues, but this is additional funding, isn't it, this grant?
This is just for housing.
Right.
And it's for, because there's such a long wait for Section 8 assistance, the state provides this program for mentally ill people who are waiting to get a voucher, basically to prevent homelessness.
So it's sort of a gap?
Yeah, that's why they call it Bridges. It's a bridge to Section 8 assistance.
Yeah. Can you tell us why you think the state, if we applied just only for 5 more, they wouldn't give it to us? I mean, can you tell us why?
Well, when we were, in January when we were doing the grant applications, they thought, you know, the staff at the state thought, you know, we got this huge budget surplus, maybe we'll get some more money for housing programs. So they encouraged us all to apply for what we really think would serve our needs the best. So given staff, given the waiting list, given all that, we applied for 5 additional.
Yeah.
Other organizations around the state also applied for additional slots. No one got additional slots. So
wow.
I think, you know, as things happened at the state legislature, they decided not to spend the surplus with a big boost to housing programs. So.
Wow.
But we're happy to get $39,000
more
than we had in the past. So.
Better than zero.
Yeah, and
but
this year we ended up with $30 in the black, so it's great budgeting.
Wow. Amazing.
Can't get much closer than that.
Yeah, so we're happy with that.
Well, I'll make a motion for acceptance of the Bridges funding grant program.
Second, no seconds.
All right, any questions? All in favor say aye.
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 Against? Passes.
Okay, great. If you'd like to hear an update on other things that are going on, I'm happy to provide that.
Anything else going on?
Well, the Mankato EDA wrote a grant to Minnesota Housing for homeownership capacity, which is more like the Home Steps First Home Program that we did before the recession. That's a very, very basic homeownership education program for emerging market families and other low-income renters. It's a lot of financial literacy, you know, very basic. What happens when you write a check? How do you use your debit card? How do you build credit, the proper use of a credit card, putting together your personal budget, the things that people need to know to get ready for home ownership. So it's a much more basic class than the Home Stretch program that we also teach every month. The Home Stretch program, in comparison, goes through every form you're going to sign at your closing, about deals with realtor contracts, that kind of thing. So it's, you know, much more sophisticated. It's for people that are about ready to pull the trigger on a purchase agreement. Whereas the Home Ownership Capacity Grant includes a lot of personalized coaching and counseling to get people to that point.
Is that the first-time home buyer thing, or is that?
It's a first-time home buyer program, very basic for people who maybe are the first people in their families to have purchased a home. One of the reasons that we were really interested in this grant opportunity is December, January, and February. Recently, we've closed three East African households on their new homes.
Yeah.
Right, and because we don't have a lot of large rental units, 4 and 5 bedrooms, to house these families, when they start working and build their credit report, if we can move them into home ownership, it frees up the large units for other families that are coming. And we do have additional immigrant families coming to town. So they come from a culture where, first of all, you don't have credit, and you don't have realtors, and so a lot of this is very foreign to them, and it's taken just a huge amount of our staff time to go with them to realtors and to lenders and to interpret and to teach them how the whole system works. So we're hoping to provide a lot of this education in Somali. We have a Somali staff person on our staff, and she's going to become a home stretch educator to help move this along. We are doing this program in partnership with Minnesota Valley Action Council. They're actually going to hold the classes in their facility. Russ Bean, who's their rehab specialist, is going to be doing the home ownership stuff, you know, how to patch your holes in your sheetrock and clear your drains and hang your light fixtures and that kind of thing. And then Ann McGregor, who's their financial counselor, is going to be teaching the financial part. My staff then will be doing the coaching after the classes and moving them into the actual closing of the homes. The city of Mankato has a revolving loan fund for first-time home buyers, so people who finish the program, graduate from the program, can receive up to $5,000 in down payment assistance and a 0% deferred loan. So we can help maybe 20 people with that, as money gets repaid to that loan fund. It'll be ongoing.
Okay. Nice.
That's an update with that. Last night, the city council passed a resolution in support of Common Bond Communities building a new tax credit apartment building on the corner of Hope and Adams. It'll be 50 affordable housing units, which we badly need in town, 1 and 2 bedroom apartments. So it'll be right across the street from Warness Plaza. So we were real happy with that. We're going to be, the Mankato EDA is going to be project basing 10 housing choice vouchers in that building. So that's good news, because there's a lot of new construction going on in Mankato, but none of it is affordable.
Right. Yeah,
we need affordable units for workforce housing, and that's what this
wonderful.
Is.
So what kind of rent does that mean per month then for a...
It'd be sort of like Cherry Ridge, $500 to $800, $500 and something
more,
for the ones, up to $800 and something.
And that's through, you said, a tax credit then?
Yeah, a low-income housing tax credit project. So they're applying to the state,
We'll find out in October if they were funded. Also, the owners of Walnut Towers are applying for 9% tax credits to rehab that building. So last month, the Mankato City Council approved a resolution of support for that tax credit application. So that'll be nice to have that building. It was built about the same time as Ornes Plaza, and I think it's about in the same kind of shape. So it'll be really nice to have those units preserved.
Nice.
You got anything else?
Well, right now, last month and this month as we speak, every single Blue Earth County public housing unit is filled. We did have somebody move out at Breckenridge. They left without notice and just totally trashed the unit, did a lot of damage. So my staff was pretty disappointed with that. But we will be looking for another family for that unit.
That doesn't happen that often.
No, we have 4 long-term homeless units at Breckenridge. And, you try to give someone a chance, you try to provide enough social services. This family was not cooperating with the social services. And there was the drug task force came and did an arrest. We still have not been able to learn who was arrested. And through the water bills, we found out there was no usage in the unit, so they've been gone for about a month, the family that was living there. So the maintenance staff went in this week and just found a disaster.
Wow.
So they took the washer, dryer, the stove, the refrigerator. They left all kinds of stuff. They shut off fire extinguishers, it's just a mess. So.
Did we get some of our smoking issues taken care of that were in some of those?
Out at Pioneer Plaza?
Yeah, I think that's where it
was. That's where the smoking was.
Madison Lake?
Yeah, that's at Pioneer Plaza. I haven't heard anything lately. So we worked with the American Lung Association, was sending people lots of things, and I think one of the heavy-duty smokers has moved out, but it's been pretty quiet so far. So sure, in the summertime it's easier because they can go outside, right, and it's not an issue.
Okay.
Right now, Pioneer Plaza, we're installing new patio doors and new windows throughout the whole building.
Oh,
so
wow.
That's going on right now.
Well, the trouble with some of those places, though, is when they do smoke inside, the air circulates throughout all the units, and then they smell. So that's
they're not supposed to be smoking inside. So
we know how that works, don't we?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Patty.
And I would request a motion to adjourn.
So move.
Second.
And a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All right. We will reconvene the county board meeting. Let me see here. I guess we can jump right into Public Works with Al and Ryan.
Welcome.
Morning.
Morning. Morning.
Beautiful summer day.
Yeah, beautiful.
We can feel it in here. Yeah.
It's supposed to be 95, I think, today, isn't it?
A lot different than last week, Al.
Yes, it was.
Al and I were both out in D.C. where it was 62 degrees and rainy.
Oh, yeah.
And 20 degrees below normal in D.C.
Well,
so. But we got our job done, didn't we,
Al? That sounds good right now.
We did. A number of good meetings.
Very good meetings.
I made a speech to the group.
You did, Al, and he made us proud.
And immediately got warm in the room.
No, Al was one of the speakers, and he made Blue Earth County proud. He did a very good job.
Very nice.
Thank you.
Go ahead, Al.
And you've got your materials with you. The first item is HSIP, Highway Safety Improvement Program. We opened bid some time ago, but because it's a federal contract, we need MnDOT approval. Contractor DBE plan needs to be approved by MnDOT. It has been now, as of yesterday, actually, right down to the wire. Earlier I passed out the bid summary. Here's the detailed bids. There was only one bidder on the project, Southern Minnesota Construction, but they did provide a good bid based on our earlier engineer's estimate. And that amount has been approved.
I'm sorry, did you say there's only one bid on all this?
Yes, there was only one bid, one bidder.
Wow.
Southern Minnesota Construction. It's for a number of different items.
Tells you how busy the summer is, though, too, everywhere.
Well, that, and it's kind of an unusual project with a combination of paving shoulders and some minor grading work and striping and signing. Yep. So it takes one contractor that is willing to put together all of these pieces.
Wow.
But the engineer's estimate was $591,859. Their bid was 11.6% under the estimate, $523,133.90. As I say, it's been approved by MnDOT. It's a 100% federal funding. So
that's something.
I would recommend approving and proceeding with the contract.
Wonderful.
Move
for
second. Got a motion and a second. Any questions? All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Against? All right, go
this
ahead.
This is every year too, isn't it, Al?
Well, it's a grant that we have to apply for. This is the first grant application. We were successful. They've gone through the plan, design, approval process. We were just awarded the second grant for 2017. So we will be following that up with plans, specs, and so on.
Well,
the second item, flood damage repair, general fund agreement. This goes back to 2010, where we had flooding. We had both FEMA and FHWA emergency repair funds. The legislature made additional funds available for the local match to the federal grant. This resolution would allow us to get about $10,132.14 to match the federal funds, which we received earlier.
Wishes of the board?
Oh, is that all we get? No, that's not.
Is that all we get?
I can't.
Can we get more?
Yeah. It needs a motion to, I suppose, approve that resolution. So I'll move it.
Second.
In response to the question, no, this isn't all we get.
Yeah, I mean,
this is just a 10 or 20% match of the
that's what I meant,
80% federal funds.
Any other questions? Next time the question comes after the motion.
Just want to make sure.
All right, all right.
Vote on, yeah.
Yeah.
All right. All in favor say aye.
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 Against? It's passed.
Okay, that's my action items, some information items. Every year we reshape some gravel roads because with the heavy loading, they get squished out, down, ditches get full of sediment, pipes are old. The two repair projects, reshaping projects we're doing this summer are County Road 109 from County 6 to County 11 north of the ethanol plant on the west side of Lake Crystal. And then the other one is County Road 187 from County 26 to County 27 north of Eagle Lake. And that's where the Lake Crystal bus lines have their barn there. One of the hopes here is that by reshaping these roads, get a good hard gravel base, reestablish drainage, get new pipes underneath them. In the future, we would have funds to do a bituminous stabilized gravel road surface on those roads.
Those two roads, they're both gravel roads.
Yes.
And they're heavily traveled, one because of the ethanol plant, the other one because of the bus garage.
Right. Right.
That would be a plus to get those blacktopped.
Definitely.
Okay.
The and you need two options there. One is to regrade the road, like we're doing at 10 or 1. But that's a very expensive option. 800,000 mile. For these two gravel roads, what I would anticipate is bituminous stabilized gravel road, like we've done out on a number of other places around the colony. that's worked quite well. Because these are heavier loads, rather than sealing with the seal coat, we may put a thin asphalt overlay, a hot mix overlay on it to provide additional strength. Okay. They have, and remarkably, those bituminous stabilized gravel roads have stood up very well to the heavy loads that all of our gravel roads get with the manure wagons and the grain wagons and the heavy farm equipment. The weak points are the edges, because there's not much of a shoulder out there to support the edge. So, yeah, I think it's worth working towards.
You've heard me talk about that, Philip.
Oh, yeah.
The four farmers that live on that road have 16 semis between them. So, it gets a lot of traffic just from the
local farmers on there.
Well, and every farmer now has got their semi. Yep. They don't have... Yep.
Three or four.
They don't have a one ton or a one axle truck like me and you.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So,
I think that would be a good idea.
How many miles about of road do you think would that be?
We have 320 miles of gravel roads.
Oh, no, I mean, these particular locations,
About two each.
2 miles each.
Yeah, I think 109 may be 3 miles and 187, 2 miles.
109 is 3 miles.
So what is
You don't think that it would give it a longer life by regrading that a little bit and kind of, you don't think it would give it a longer life, the road itself?
Well, the object of this summer's work
is
to reshape those roads so we'll have a good, firm, shaped road bed, clean the ditches out to establish drainage, new pipes so you don't have to dig it up and replace pipes in the future.
Okay.
And then it would sit for a year or two, harden up, any settlement out of it, and then you would put this cold mix on it.
Okay.
The cold mix, the most successful, we've tried a number of different things over the years. The most successful has been to wrap recycled asphalt product, put down about 6 inches of that on top of the gravel road.
Okay.
And then you mix in asphalt emulsion with that, big rototiller, plate it out, compact it, and then put a double seal coat on it.
Okay.
I think on these two roads, we would consider putting a thin hot mix asphalt on top of it.
Additional.
Yeah.
Okay.
And the heavier tonnage, heavier weight.
Yep.
It's only 4 miles, and it just seems like it would be good to try to bolster it if it gets that kind of traffic.
Yeah. And over the years now, we've done on the order of maybe 25 miles of this.
Okay.
And for these heavier used gravel roads, county roads, see, and this is on the county road system, so we don't have the state aid gas tax money available to us. It has worked quite well, really, and the maintenance costs of those roads are only getting higher as gravel gets more expensive.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
The people really like it. You know, you don't have the dust and you don't have the constant bumps and softening up in the spring.
All right.
Okay. County 12 project, as you know, thanks to the board providing some specific funds for right-of-way design, we're proceeding with that, starting in the south end with the one residential relocation and then moving to the north. Charter Communication has recently decided to remove their communication tower, which helps us.
Wow. It
frees up a little bit of right-of-way for us.
You mean that whole section they've got right there?
Well, they have, if you drive down that gravel road, Carver Road, there's a tall tower.
Yeah.
Okay, that's Charter Communications tower. That's probably gone today, actually. They decided that it's obsolete, and so we won't have to work around their guy wires
going
to have to. Yes. And we did design a way to get through there without having to relocate either Hickory Tech's facility in Ventus or this big tall tower.
Yeah.
But this will allow us to go through more smoothly. Really.
Wow.
So that's a fortuitous item.
Really good.
Yeah. We had a design question on the Hoffman Road intersection. I think I provided some additional information on that specific location.
Yeah.
And then an opportunity that came up very recently with the construction of the school. The school will have a large holding pond. The contractor there will have to excavate and remove 100,000 cubic yards. Actually more than that, a couple hundred thousand cubic yards. He's found a home for the first 100,000. He needs a home for the second 100,000. So we have free access to 100,000 cubic yards of fill, which is about as much as we will need to build the road.
Mm. Amazing.
We would have to pick up this dirt, and the contractor will do that at no cost to us. we'd have to get a rental lease, or if we can move, purchase ahead quickly, purchase the property on the alignment, and then place that fill there. That will save us any order of $300,000 to $400,000. But, you know, people will see activity out there moving and stockpiling this dirt, so I wanted to make sure you folks were aware of that.
Okay, yeah.
That'd be amazing.
Yeah, it is. It's a windfall.
Was there any wiggle room for anything? So there's all winners, sort of, so to speak, or everybody's, I mean, nobody's ever totally happy when designing a road, you know, sometimes. But with that one intersection, was there a little wiggle room or not, or is it pretty?
Yeah, no, we tried to accommodate his concerns. If when you see the final design, you'll see that roundabout has shifted south a little bit and it's skewed a little bit.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yep. All right. And then there may be a workshop later where transportation funding will be discussed and connects, of course, to this project.
Yeah, I know. When I saw this on here, I wasn't sure if you wanted to mention anything about that, because I don't know if the general public, you know, really tracks everything, but that we've used general funds to go ahead with the right-of-way purchases, and that's, you know, what was it, $1.5 million
right.
We set aside?
Yes.
And that could have been, you know, a very small percentage of a penny, you know, from our sales if we wanted to help pay for that instead. Because that's a road that's going to be used by people all throughout the region, not just Blue Earth County.
That's right.
And we're using just Blue Earth County funds.
That's right.
To purchase that land.
Yeah.
And the people who benefit are going to be a lot of people outside of Mankato. So, anyway.
And we did submit the Tiger Grant.
Oh, good.
It's at 10 o'clock last Thursday night.
Yeah.
We were in D.C.
Is that a group
effort?
The
internet allows you to work any place, anytime. It's great.
And you put odds on it? Is it better than the church, than the American Pharaoh, as far as
bet?
The odds
crown.
On getting the
triple
Tiger
crown.
Grant?
Yeah. Well, I had a lot of money in that horse, actually.
Well, then maybe you'll be lucky. We'll be lucky with the Tiger Grant.
Our chances are increasing. I don't know what they are, really. We've got a very good project. Doug Hader, the former state engineer, helped us with the grant application. I feel we have a very well-written grant application.
Oh, good.
Other agencies are getting discouraged from applying for these grants and not getting them.
Right.
And so the number is declining. So it's hard to say.
We had a lot of good conversations with folks in Washington about this.
Yes.
One of the most positive, I think, was Rick Nolan, who's on the transportation committee, and he wanted to get information on this grant so he could put his, and he said that there's even though we don't have earmarks anymore, it was his understanding is they still take a lot of viewpoints from the congressman. So that was very positive. I got some real, you know, when Al and I talked to Mr. Nolan, I think both of us were pretty impressed with what his views and how much he was willing to help Southern Minnesota, which to me is, you know, it's out of his district, and I was impressed with that.
It's nice.
All of our, both the Senator's office and Representative Waltz and Representative Nolan indicate they supported and thought we had a good project. Mr. Nolan volunteered to go and talk to Mr. Fox, who is the head of the U.S. Transportation Department, about this project and other projects of interest.
Yeah. He spoke to NACO too, I think.
Yeah.
Mr. Fox was there really last year.
Yeah.
Al, isn't it true that maybe the Tiger Grant that was approved by Congress is a little bit higher this time too? It's a little bit larger? That's right. I thought it was larger.
This is
the pool.
Two rounds where Congress has appropriated money for Tiger Grants, and I believe the second round was a little bigger. The Congress now needs to consider reauthorizing the expired transportation bill. They've been continuing the resolutions for like 20 times or something.
Yeah, I know. I thought it was like 600 and some million or something. I wasn't sure.
So hopefully the new authorization or the continuing resolution will include additional funds for Tiger Grants. It's one of the things that NACO and counties are asking for.
Yeah.
We got to keep on going here.
Okay.
Right.
Sorry.
Other projects this summer, the three bridges on County 5 near Bedders Quarry, that end of the road. I really would like to get those deck replaced late this year, this fall. They're in very bad condition. The legislature does have a compromise bonding bill that would have $6.85 million for local bridge bonding. So if that passes, it'll be up to the state. That's not nearly enough, whether we get funds or not, which would provide 50% of the funding for those bridge decks. If we don't, I would propose using our regular state aid in order to get those bridges done.
Okay.
I think it's that important. And we have, as you know, our the 2 minutes and our number one project came in below our estimate, so we would have funds to do that.
One quick comment. Can I just say one quick comment? I know we're a little behind. They're trying to get that state trail system.
Yeah.
There's a disconnect right about there.
Right.
And so they might have to use the road. And I don't know if there's any way of talking about that in the future, but we can make a note about it, about maybe making it a little wider for bicycles to get across that bridge.
Yeah, I've talked to Craig Beckman about that.
Okay.
And the problem is, I feel it would be very unsafe to have trail traffic on that road.
They're going to put it on that road, though.
Well.
Unless something breaks in that community.
Yeah, I know.
Even though they don't realize it actually increases their property values by having a nice trail through there. Yeah. It's more desirable, but... You know, yeah. Be that as it may, I think so far their plan is to connect using that, one of their connections.
So what you're suggesting is we review the width of those bridge decks.
Yeah, just the width. So it's a little safer.
The other consideration, too, is we need a Corps of Engineers permit, NDNR, NBOSER permit, and MVCA permit for those three bridge decks. The Corps permit, one of them we have to cut down some trees, and the long-eared bat has raised its ears.
Yeah, we heard it. We know all about the long-eared bat.
We heard it. Fungi. You're a fungi.
Let's keep going here. Yeah.
So we need permission from the Fish and Wildlife Service, and that is temporarily delaying the permit for the one bridge. County 1 from Highway 30 to Good Thunder is under construction.
Nice.
And County 72 in Vernon Center has been awarded by the city to Holtmeyer Construction.
Oh, yeah.
The bituminous overlay contract, they're doing the work in Bray Park today, and we'll follow up with County 32 and County 90. The Le Sueur River Bank erosion mitigation projects, we will be closing on those two houses on July 6th. We'll have a contract for the board to consider and an award on the July 7th meeting. So we'll have minimum exposure to actually owning it before they get torn out.
Yeah.
County Road 147 bridge starts this fall, and then we'll also be closing on the Saddle Club Parkland on June 30th.
Okay.
Yeah.
Quick question on the riverbank projects where the homes are being removed. Yeah. Do the neighbors have access to that property, or what happens to that? Just a few lots there, I know, but just what do you do?
When the houses are removed, the basements will be filled, it'll be leveled, black dirt, seeded, and it'll have to stay that way, not be developed forever. That's one of the requirements of the grant. If the neighbors want to mow it and use it as their lawn or make a garden, why, more power to them.
Okay. Just curious. Yeah.
It's two lots, so.
Yeah, it's two lots there.
Different.
Yep.
Otherwise, we'll go out there a couple times a summer and mow it with our highway mower.
Yeah, and that's they're being taken down because the river, the Sueur River, has eroded away all the soil up almost to the backyard or back door of the houses right there.
Literally.
Literally.
Yeah, one is even.
Yeah.
Okay. Probably 3-4 feet. Yeah.
Yeah. At best.
All right.
Okay.
So you're planning on adjourning at 10 and then
well,
starting the workshop at
10:30? Well, we have some more stuff to do here before we adjourn, so...
Okay.
I don't know if we can get through it in 10 minutes, but...
Probably can.
We have a lot of stuff to go over between now and then.
If the board would like, I'll just hang around until your workshop and...
Okay, that'd be fine.
Okay. Yeah.
Thanks,
Thank
Al.
You. Thank you very
Thanks,
much.
Ryan.
Thanks,
you.
Ryan.
Pat? We're going to move along here.
Yeah.
Move along. I'll catch you up. I'll make sure that get you some time back.
What do you want to wonder?
Essentially, the numbers are what they are. And just to give you a little bit of an idea, I did check Commissioner Campbell just before I came down here. Just to give you an example, the felony numbers for 2014 at this juncture, at the end of April, we were at 100 more than what we were last year.
Oh, really?
Time.
Okay.
So, with that and just a couple of other things, the truancy numbers appear to be up But I think that obviously, since we won't be having any truancies during the summertime, but there might be a little bit of a difference in the counting of numbers from the school standpoints, because I've been having ongoing conversations with some of the school districts regarding, you know, are we going to, normally it's 7 unexcused absences before they are brought into court. So is that during a school year? Is that during a calendar year? So if there's some troubled individuals at the end of this school year, we're probably going to pick them up right at the beginning if they start having trouble at the beginning of next school year. Other than that, the TPRs and the CHIPs seem about going along as where they normally would be. Nothing major there. But other than that, I will just turn it over to any of you if you have any questions, answer your questions so you can keep your meeting moving along on time.
That was my question again, would just be, you know, the trend, is there a big difference we see now as compared to last year? You know what I mean? Because that would indicate that there's going to be some more extra work.
Well, there is, and I know a couple of you attended the state demographer's presentation and the Pinocchio effect, you know, and as a trend nationally and even in Minnesota, crime has gone down over the years, but violent crimes have gone up. And part of the issue with Blue Earth County is that, you know, we have one of the second largest university in the state. We have what the state demographer referred to as the Pinocchio effect, young adults from 18 to 24. That's the largest amount of that produce crimes in the area. So, you know, there's all sorts of numbers and all sorts of different ways you can look at this and whatnot. But I mean, there's very many different factors that come into things, and I think all of you are aware of the economic growth and everything in the area. It's just a matter of, I can't point at any specific one type of crime and say that crime's running amok, but it's just things are growing, and they will continue to grow as they will in the future. So, anything else? Otherwise, I'll just turn things back over so you can
Looks
continue
great.
On, Mr. Yeah,
thank
Chair.
Thank you very much. For that.
Thanks for
just
all
one
reports.
Question, Pat, before you go. You've talked about the backlog. You've caught up on the backlog.
The backlog is pretty much caught up. I would say yes.
Does that reflect in these numbers on the
it, filling? It does to an extent, but not to a great extent. But yeah, we're caught up because the last report that I was run, I believe, was on Friday. From an adult standpoint, we have about 50 pending cases, which isn't out of the ordinary at any given point in time. And I mean, I think that's pretty good.
That's awesome.
So, but no, and so I can't say that there's. Yes, that's part of the back or part of the backlog is in there.
Okay, thank
nice,
you.
Nice, thank you.
Thanks, Pat.
Thanks, Pat.
All right. Should we jump back to administrative services, Bob?
Mr. Chair and Commissioners, the first item is the county board minutes from May 26th of this year.
I'll move the minutes.
Second.
Motion is second. Any questions? All in favor say aye.
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 Against? Go ahead.
Next up will be the bills for the weeks of May 21st and May 28th.
I'll move the bills.
Got a motion? Got a second?
Second.
We're not paying them.
Yeah, I guess, yeah.
Got a motion and a second. Any questions?
I just had a couple. I didn't get a chance to really connect. First one on there, it says, you know, I was just looking at it. I'm assuming, now, I don't know if he's separated or not, but because he used to be with Gisselson and Hunter, but it says Law Office of Kenneth White. Is he still in with Gisselson and Hunter, or is he not with them anymore?
Not that I'm aware of.
No,
he's
in
a private.
He's got a private practice.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm curious. And those must be for the work we were doing the last few years, I'm sure. Is that the final?
That was part of the budget appeal on the county attorney's pay.
Yeah.
And so that is the final charges that we'll receive from Mr. White.
Okay. And then Mid-States Equipment and Supply on that same week. It just says other supplies for the road, $23,000. I'm just curious where we spent it, if you do have it.
Yeah, that's some crack sealing material that was purchased in the Public Works Department.
And then the second week, there's more roads, it's called Crop Production Services, and it says other maintenance road supplies also. Crop Production Services, and I'm just curious, maybe that's seeding or something, you know, I don't know. $5,391. second week.
That is herbicide for weed spraying.
Oh, wow, okay.
Herbicide. Again, in the Public Works Department.
Probably the ditches or something?
Yes.
One quick one then. Kringle Brothers Incorporated, contracted services for $10,000.
County ditch probably, but that I don't remember which one.
Is that in week one?
Two.
K-R-E-N.
Yeah.
Oh, there it is.
$10,639.
Yeah, there were ditch repairs on CD-35 and CD-57.
Oh, okay.
In case it.
All right, thank you.
Any other questions? All in favor say aye.
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 Against? Go ahead, Bob.
Item number three in your packet is the Human Resources Department agenda. We just have informational items this morning. We have the promotion of an assistant county attorney to the division chief in the county attorney's office to backfill the position that Pat has left. And so we have initiated recruitment to refill the assistant county attorney. And then we have a promotion of land use specialist to replace Stacy Fesser in the Environmental Services Department. And finally, the employment of a patrol officer as part of a new position that was authorized by the board for 2015. Any questions on the human resources agenda? Next up then is a premises permit application for a gambling activity at the Windmill Bar in Mapleton. This is a request by the Heather Curling Club to, I believe, sell pull tabs. And so seeking board support and approval of this gambling permit.
I'd move that.
Second.
Got a motion and a second. Any questions? All in favor say aye.
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 Against? Go ahead, Bob.
Item number five then in your packet is another application for a gambling permit by the Cambria Presbyterian Church for a raffle that they will be holding in October of this year.
Move approval.
Second.
Got a motion second. Any questions? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Against? Pass.
Item number six then is a supplemental boating safety patrol grant agreement. This supports our boat and water safety officer, additional $4,500 being made available to Blue Earth County by the state of Minnesota through the DNR, and so recommending approval of this grant.
I'll make motion for approval.
Second.
This is something we do every year too.
Yep.
That's correct.
And a motion and a second. All in favor say aye.
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 Against? Passed.
Mr. Chair and Commissioners, item number seven in your packet is a recommendation for an appointment to the Planning Commission and the Board of Adjustment. Mr. Perry Wood has resigned his appointment, and so Mr. Joseph Smentek has indicated interest.
Okay. We made a phone call this morning. Me and you made a phone call to Joe, and I got an answering machine. I noticed that I did receive a call. I'm not sure if it was from him, but I'd like to take about 2 minutes, go into my office, and find out, because we had some questions from Joe. So I'm going to take just like about a 5 minute break.
That'd be great.
And I'll make that phone call and make sure we get our questions before we go on to this.
All right.
Thank you. As I said, I tried to make a phone call to Mr. Schmizek. I was not able to get a hold of him. He's in a ditch hearing. You know,
okay.
He said an exciting one. Mm. So I'm sure Kip and Will know all about those. With this, we have some questions I'm going to ask. That we have a motion to table this.
Okay.
There are some questions that we need to talk to Mr. Schmizek about. Is there a problem with the Planning Commission going another 2 weeks without
Well, it'll probably prevent him from attending the July meeting. That would be the one downside to that, but I understand there's concerns about his current involvement in the Mankato Planning Commission, and would that be a conflict of any sort to participating on the Blue Earth County Planning Commission? So I think it's wise at this point with those questions out there that we wait for a couple weeks and try and sort some of that out.
We got a good board. We get a quorum there every time. So
yeah.
All right.
I'll move to table.
That motion is
table. You don't even need to. If there's a motion, I think we just table it.
Oh, yeah.
We just table it.
That's true. Well, I was asking for a motion.
Oh, yeah, I'm sorry.
Yeah, he's not.
Go ahead, motion to table. I can't. Mark.
Yeah. We got a motion to table and a second, and we will table this until our next meeting.
Very good. Good.
And I need a motion to adjourn.
Are we done with everything now?
We'll move to adjourn.
And second.
We got a motion and a second to adjourn. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
And we will now move to our work session. Are we going to move out of here?
Chair, we'll move to the fireplace room and we'll reconvene at 10:30.
All right.
Work session.